Lakers Nation, welcome in. Lakers haters out in full force now that the Lakers have lost in round one to the Phoenix Suns. But you know what? There's an old saying, better to be thought a fool and remain silent than to open your mouth and remove all doubt. And let me tell you, there's a lot of people right now out there opening their mouths and exposing themselves as fools. Joining me is Ron Gutterman to help laugh at some of these haters. How are you doing, Ron?
Doing great. You know, laughing at Lakers haters is a real passion of mine. It's something I really enjoy doing. So it's great. I'm very excited to do this.
Well, let's kick it off with this thing. Bubble frauds. I've been seeing that time and time again, that somehow the Lakers losing here early in the NBA playoffs means that the 2020 NBA championship is clearly not a valid title. I'm assuming you've been seeing a lot of that as well.
Yeah, look, while I think calling LeBron James Le Mickey and calling Anthony Davis A. Disney are very hilarious nicknames, and I would absolutely find it funny in any other context. Using it to say that, like, a whole championship didn't count is really ridiculous because, like, somehow, miraculously, the 2020 championship is the first one ever that didn't count. Just throw it out like it never happened. Like, that makes no sense.
Well, and it's revisionist history, too, to somehow suggest that it was so easy to win this championship that it simply should not count. When going in, the narrative was this was going to be one of the most difficult championships to win because of everything that was happening here. And in fact, I think you can make the argument that this is the fairest championship ever. There was no home court advantage, which hurt the Lakers. No home court advantage. That got taken away from them as the number one seed. They were going to enjoy home court. Instead, everybody is on a level playing field, and everybody had 4 months off between then and the start of the bubble season slash playoffs. So if anything, you had the teams about as even as you possibly could heading into that experience.
Not only heading in, while they were there, you know, the no travel, very consistent routine schedules, like all the Lakers games were at 6 p.m. Pacific, like 9 p.m. Eastern. It was all the same. It was a very regimented time because they needed to keep things separate from each other. So because there was no travel and it was very everything was very regimented, it just was so even. It was such a even playing field for everyone.
So, and we've got people saying that these championship or that championship somehow did not count, saying that the Lakers had an easy path through to the finals, and using the fact that a lot of the teams that played deep in the playoffs that year are now out. So they say, look at the Miami Heat and the Lakers, both out in the first round. Clearly, they only won because of the bubble. Isn't that just conveniently overlooking the fact that maybe, just maybe, Ron, the teams that are out early in this season's playoffs were dealing with the fatigue of playing deep in last season's playoffs and then having a quick turnaround? I don't think that is coincidence.
Yeah, I mean, Kentavious Caldwell-Pope in his exit interview basically said they couldn't even differentiate between the end of the 2020 season and the beginning of this season. It all felt like just one never-ending season. And that's like not a good thing. You win a championship and then essentially 40 days later, you have to start training camp for the next season. That's absolutely ridiculous. There's no reason that the Lakers should have been expected to come out of the gates firing on all cylinders, even though they kind of did. There's no way that any of the teams from last year's finals or conference finals should have been expected to make deep playoff runs and essentially play two consecutive years of NBA basketball.
I mean, look at it, right? Just look at the teams. The Lakers, right? Came out firing, but then just got hit by a tidal wave of injuries, one after another, continued into the playoffs. Nonstop injuries. The Miami Heat, on fumes most of the season, right? Clearly, the Boston Celtics, right before the playoffs start, boom, Jaylen Brown, massive injury. And they dealt with a ton of injuries all season long. The Denver Nuggets, they're still playing, but Jamal Murray is gone. Why? Major injury. Not a coincidence that that's happening. So again, I don't think you can look at what's happened here and say, oh, this is proof now, proof that that 2020 championship simply doesn't count. In fact, I think you can make an argument that that 2020 championship should count more because of all of the particulars and how much more difficult it was without home court advantage for the one seed to go all the way through and win that championship last year.
Yeah, and I do want to give credit to some non-Lakers people out there in the media and fans. There are some non-Lakers people that have made some very good points about this championship, saying being honest, were the Lakers were by far the best team going into the bubble. Every statistic, every metric, everything that was happening on the court was an indicator that the Lakers were the best team in the NBA last season. There's almost nothing to prove otherwise. So the championship matched what was happening during the regular season and in the bubble.
And let's not forget, you know, I want to close on this topic with this. The people that are saying, oh, the 4 months off helped LeBron, it helped Anthony Davis, it helped these guys, right? They're forgetting that the Lakers were firing on all cylinders. They just started picking things up. They beat right before the cord got kicked out of the wall and the plug got pulled on the season. They beat the Bucks and the Clippers. It was the Bucks, Clippers, and Lakers last season that were considered the top three teams, the most likely to win a championship. The Lakers beat both of them the same weekend, right before the plug got pulled. The Lakers were firing on all cylinders and then got the season shut down and had to rediscover their chemistry in the bubble. So don't come at me with this whole 2020 NBA championship thing does not count. But there's another thing that's happening. Another common commonality from Lakers haters. And that is this concept that the Lakers gave up their entire future for the measly sum of one NBA championship run. I've got a tweet here. Julius Randle, the Lakers really sacrificed Julius Randle, Brandon Ingram, Lonzo Ball, Jordan Clarkson, D'Angelo Russell, Josh Hart, Larry Nance Jr. for one chip. Ron, wouldn't we all, wouldn't anyone, wouldn't all 30 teams in the NBA make that trade?
I mean, look, by the way, shout out to the Lakers scouting department. You guys are incredible. Right? That's an awesome list of NBA players. There's a couple things here. Look, all of those players are wonderful. But yes, you sacrifice anyone and everyone in the world to get a championship. That's why they play the sport. They wouldn't play the sport if there was no championships at the end of it. That's the reason the league was created. That's the reason the sport exists at such a high level today. Because of championships. That's the point.
Well, Ron, this is haters coming out and trying to suggest that as much as they're reveling right now that the Lakers are out in the first round, that it's not just going to be this year, but into the future. That the Lakers are done, right? The Lakers gave up their entire future for this one championship, and from here on out, it's going to be nothing. That's what they're suggesting. How old is Anthony Davis again?
He's actually 27, turning 28 prior to next season.
Oh, he's done. Clearly, right? He's done. Father Time is undefeated. He's an old man. Might as well retire.
Yeah, he's done. Yeah, no, I mean, you're right. It's absolutely ridiculous to suggest not only... It's ridiculous to suggest that one championship isn't worth it. That's the whole point. Mm-hmm. But it's also ridiculous to suggest that having a superstar duo with one of those superstars being a couple years shy of 30... to assume that they're never going to contend for a championship again. Ridiculous. The Lakers will be back, and I'm not guaranteeing championships in the future, but I'm guaranteeing they'll be there in the conversation for a couple years here.
You know, this topic came up on Twitter, and I just put out there a very basic, very simple statement. The Anthony Davis trade was a massive success for the Lakers. Period. Right? They got a championship out of it. That's all that matters, right? You can go back and try to relitigate it and say, oh, they gave up too much because the picks and all this stuff. And now Brandon Ingram looks good or Julius Randle looks good. That's great. I love that those guys look good. But you would do that trade 100 times out of 100 in the moment. And now that you know you got a championship out of it, you would absolutely do that trade. You would be a fool to not do that deal, to not give up what they did in order to get Anthony Davis and an NBA championship, number 17 for the franchise.
Yeah, and there's two points that come to mind that I want to make here. The first one is this. Can you, can you relist all of the players listed in that tweet?
Yeah, Julius Randle, Brandon Ingram, Lonzo Ball, Jordan Clarkson, D'Angelo Russell, Josh Hart, Larry Nance Jr.
Okay, my first point is this. All of those players combined have zero championships. Jordan Clarkson is the only one of those players that could theoretically get a championship this year. Good for him. Now the second point. Imagine that all of those players, imagine magically the Lakers were able to retain and pay every single one of those players, which is not possible.
No, they wouldn't be able to.
But let's just say let's just say they managed to keep all of those guys and all of those players were on the Lakers right now, and that was their roster. Does that team win a championship?
No.
Probably not. They're probably like a 4-5 seed in the Western Conference, maybe second round exit.
That's a good team, but who's your 1A guy? Like, who's your alpha on that squad?
Doesn't it? It's Brandon Ingram. It's
Brandon Ingram, but that's not his personality. So if you were just to keep all of those guys, you could have a decent team. Now, and again, credit to the Lakers drafting, right? But that team's not winning you a championship. The Lakers made the move they needed to do in order to win a championship, and it worked.
Yep.
Big success. Last thing that we're seeing quite a bit of out there from Lakers haters, from Hater Nation, if you will. The Lakers parted ways with Dwight Howard, JaVale McGee, Rajon Rondo, and Danny Green in search of upgrades. All four of those guys are still in the playoffs. The Lakers are not. Oh, boy, Ron. I even get this from some Lakers fans saying, see, this is proof the Lakers should have kept JaVale, should have kept Dwight Howard. Ron, how is JaVale and Rondo doing right now in the playoffs, by the way?
Well, so we dug into this a little bit. JaVale McGee has actually played a total of 7 minutes so far in the playoffs for the Denver Nuggets.
7 minutes a game?
Total. That's not an
average. Oh, total. Wow. Total.
7 minutes.
Impact player. Yeah. Okay.
And all seven of those minutes actually came in one game, and it was a blowout. So he's a garbage time backup.
Seven garbage time minutes.
On a team that's right now in the second round.
Okay.
So we can move on to Rondo. You know, playoff Rondo. The Lakers absolutely should have kept him. He would have put the Lakers on his back and won this series. Except he got replaced in the rotation by Terrence Mann for the Clippers, and he played a total of 19 minutes in games 6 and 7 when the Clippers trailed 3-2 against the Mavericks. So
that's what's going on. What happened to playoff Rondo?
Well, look, playoff Rondo appears to be dead. Eventually, Father Time is undefeated, and Father Time is coming for Rajon Rondo. He might still be good in these playoffs. He might turn things around for the Clippers in the second round against Utah and any further rounds they may or may not be in. But in the first round against Dallas, he was a bust. He was not very good. He shot poorly. He defended poorly. He was very bad for the Clippers in the first round.
He was so bad that he got replaced by the guy from Field of Dreams, is what you're telling me. Terrence Mann went ahead and took his spot, James Earl Jones. No, Terrence Mann, the basketball player. He's pretty good. And you know, I don't want to hate on Rondo. I've still got my Rondo jersey from last year. But the point is, Rondo sticking with the Lakers wouldn't have changed the outcome. He hasn't been that guy this year. JaVale sticking with the Lakers wouldn't have changed the outcome we just saw. He has not been that guy this year. Now, we can maybe talk chemistry, but I don't think you can look at what the Lakers did and not say that they've upgraded. I mean, Dwight Howard has pretty much been Dwight Howard. He hasn't done anything that remarkable come playoff time. Again, he's been okay. Danny Green, I think, is the one guy who has. Danny Green's the one guy who's shooting over 40% from three in the playoffs, right? And so you can say, hey, Danny Green certainly could have helped the Lakers this year if he's shooting over 40% from three. He's also averaging over a block and steal per game. Love that. Great job, Danny Green. But guess what? Out of all of those guys, that was also the guy that Lakers fans most wanted to get rid of. So he was not playing that well for the Lakers at the time. So to suggest that Rob Pelinka ruined the team, if he had just kept all those guys, everything would have been fine. It's madness.
No, I mean, look, with all the injuries that hit the Lakers this season, it was the only reason the Lakers even made the playoffs at all was because when LeBron went down, when Anthony Davis went down, who did they have carrying them? A 27-year-old Dennis Schroeder and a 27-year-old Montrezl Harrell, both of whom would not be there if the Lakers had just kept all those guys. If LeBron and AD get injured and you're relying on Rajon Rondo, Danny Green, and Dwight Howard, you're out of the playoffs. That's it. It's over.
And that's certainly a possibility, right? That could be the reality we're looking at had the Lakers just stood pat. Now, of course, you could say, well, chemistry would have been better, and there's a lot of different ways this can go. But the bottom line is that when you look at what the Lakers did, and the Lakers haters running around saying, oh, the Lakers, they ruined their team by making these moves. Again, every team in the NBA would have made these moves. You're telling me that you wouldn't, if you're an NBA team, you wouldn't want to get the sixth man of the year and the runner up to sixth man of the year, who are both significantly younger than the guys they're replacing. So you get better players who are younger. You wouldn't make that move? No, every team in the NBA would make that move. It didn't work out perfectly for the Lakers. They didn't wind up advancing this season. But those are moves that you make 100 times out of 100.
Yeah, and I think it's a testament. It's kind of it's an overarching sentiment for both Lakers fans and kind of the a little bit spoiled life that we as Lakers fans sure. have been living. And it's also a testament to how prevalent the Lakers are in the minds of other fans. The fact that they can get eliminated from the first round, which, by the way, is the fate of eight teams every single year. Eight teams get eliminated in the first round every single year. The Lakers being that team one time is like proof of an avalanche of terrible, terrible decisions, when in reality, they were just a team that was injured and just didn't have what it took to get out of the first round this year. It happens to a lot of teams every single year. And in fact, if you look at Portland, take a look at the Portland Trailblazers. They have Damian Lillard, CJ McCollum, Yusuf Nurkic. They got a good team. They've been out of the first round four of the last 5 years. It just happens sometimes. You just don't make it that. You don't win a championship every time you make the playoffs.
But again, what this all wraps up to, like you said, Ron, it's the fact that the Lakers do have 17 championships. And so if there is a situation like this, then the haters do come out of the woodwork. But again, I think the things that they're being criticized for right now, the things that we're hearing shouted from the mountaintops in celebration by fans of 29 other NBA teams, it's just really, really foolish when you look at it and you really dig into what they're saying.
Yeah, definitely foolish. Definitely not good arguments. I'm all for legitimate critiques of the Lakers. I am not for trolls and whatever, just saying whatever they need to discredit the Lakers and, in a way, LeBron James as well.
All right, everybody. Let us know your thoughts in the comments down below. In fact, let us know what you're seeing out there from Lakers haters. How many ridiculous statements have you seen? What are some of the best of them? And by best, I mean, of course, the worst. Fire them off in the comments down below. And don't forget, subscribe right here to the Lakers Nation YouTube channel and ring that notification bell. Till next time, see ya and stay safe.